Hi, this is your host Ajay Verma from Civils Daily. So let's start the session. So for everybody in the session, let me tell you. So Prabhat is just like my brother. I've known him for last 7-8 years. Okay, when I was preparing, he also came and we had a like very good bond and we started studying. Okay, so we have gone through this journey, ups and downs of UPSC preparation together. I've seen his situations. Okay, to give you a brief background, okay, my perceptions of Prabhat, I'll tell you. So when I first met him, he started preparation. He was a bright candidate, but I believe in the initial phase of preparation, he was not consistent and he was running after too many things. Okay, and that's why in the initial phase of preparation, he did face a lot of problems. Okay, and but during this time, last 7-8 years of journey, he has seen too many failures, lots of personal losses also. Okay, and but what happens is we always say that everything ends well. So his hard work and consistency finally paid off in 2019, where we found his name in UPSC list. Before that one also, like before that in 2018 is also itself, he qualified Gujarat PSC. He was working as a income tax, right, Prabhat? State services he was selected, but he was continuing preparation for UPSC and then started got selected in 2019. So Prabhat, first question for you, like in this long journey of failures, personal losses, like how did you keep yourself motivated? What help you go through? Yes, Prabhat, can you explain?
Yes, Ajay. Ajay, see, the journey, it starts for everyone with the same aspirations, right? Every student has the same aspiration when you start the journey. Get into good services, get good career, and a dream job. But then, the first thing that strikes you in UPSC is when you cannot make it in the first place. Then the real struggle starts. Then comes in the part of real motivation and inspiration. So I think so motivation definitely is very essential for everyone. But as you also are aware that motivation is short-lived. It has a short tendency. But if you have a particular inspiration in your life that you want to do that particular thing or you want to achieve some goal, that inspiration will drive you through the long journey. So I request every student or aspirant who starts his preparation, the first thing you need to be clear about what inspires you to be a civil servant. Is it just the luxury, or is it just the name fame, or is it just the love for the uniform? Because all these things are particularly motivation and they'll help you to give attempts. But if at all by somehow you miss chance of getting your name in the list, you will need a purse. Particular inspiration to move on continuously, and you keep getting motivation from your life experiences, as I got in myself. Kabhi ghar pe failures, kabhi personal life mein, kabhi professional life mein. So even there, my failures added a great amount to my journey. They kept me motivated. Okay, I can do better now. I can do better. So these my failures were my continuous motivation and my inspiration to work, because since the hardship which we have seen in childhood. And my parents' dream and the belief of your family. These were the continuous inspiring factors in my journey to work. Okay. So I think so. A clear head is very necessary when you start your journey. Okay.
So I believe, like to sum it up, I believe like civil services should be a calling for you, right? If you are coming for the respect of society or all the peripherals that come with the job, then you will lose the motivation in the journey.
Yeah, because somehow, somewhere you will see the charm is somewhere else. You see glamour. For example, I did law in meanwhile. So I saw that, okay, law also has a good chance to serve. But again, you see the glamour over there, then you get attracted. But again, if you are inspired to be a civil servant, then these distractions won't let you go out of the way.
So you have to find that inspiration. So during the preparation time only, I'll tell you that hum log to shuru se, we all say that Prabhat to vardi wala banega. Okay. So he has a very high passion for the khaki for India. And although he has qualified as IRPS, he is giving this attempt itself to for rank improvement and getting it to IPS, right?
Yes.
So Prabhat, IPS was your first preference. So what kind of questions did they ask in personality test? Did they like grill you on that?
No, Ajay, for me, I think so. Detailed application form, DAF, which is called, it worked out to be in my favor because of my job preferences. My first preference was Indian Police Services. And since I also done my law and master's in law, that was one factor. And apart from that, I was continuously into sports in some or the other way. So my aptitude was also reflected in my DAF, that I want to get into legal, something more which has direct link with the legal and society and civil services.
Yes, great. So I believe some people like your UPSC interviews are going to be conducted this next month itself, right? So this you should always keep in mind, right? Your filling of DAF must be according to your preferences and your personality, right? So I know that during this long journey after failures, that you had some mentors also with you, right? First of all, I believe like Avadh Oja sir from Vajiram has a great influence on your life. You have almost family connections with him. Okay, you had some seniors also in this field. So how much important it is to have those kind of mentors in your life?
This is very important thing I'd like to say. See, for a very average student like me, and as you mentioned, a very distracted student like me, who just had one inspiration to work in civil services, but I had no idea how to do it and how to go about it. Avadh sir, I met him in Ahmedabad, and he was the first person to tell me that whatever you are doing right now is not the right way to go about it. He immediately called me to Delhi. Back then, Delhi was the hub, Mukherjee Nagar was the hub. And luckily, stars were in my favor. The place where I went to stay first, you were my first neighbor. And you were the second mentor I met in my journey. So, mentor is very essential because back then when I came, in my entire family, no one has anything to do with civil services. In fact, when I cleared my civil services, my dad was not aware that IAS ka exam alag hota hai, IPS ka alag hota hai, UPSC kya. So, from that way, place I have come. Even my brother was not aware about the entire process. What is prelim, what is main. He knew that UPSC and IAS, he is working in a very good job. He knows the reputation of an officer. But there was no guidance. So, mentorship, I got from Oja sir. He told me how to go about it, how to prepare, how to make notes, everything, every small little thing. Then I still remember we used to discuss before prelims, you and me. We were 3-4 friends and we used to take mock tests. Sitting at our home, that time CSAT was a paper counted in merit. So we used to sit with a stopwatch and do test papers. So that is how I was guided back then. But then again, what happened? In 2014, I lost touch with everyone, even with you due to some personal reasons and with my family. So what happened? This mentorship was lost, this guide was lost. So after my first two attempts, I was a little distracted again. Then again, I went to some darkness. So what happens? A mentor or a guru will play the role of a continuous guiding light in your journey. Had I had the benefit of getting a continuous mentorship, I think so, around 2013-14, so I would have not taken these many years. I would have not skipped 14 or 15 attempts. I would have continuously prepared. And I got a little scared of my failure. So a strategy, whichever I used to devise, was not so worth it because I used to evaluate it on my basis only. So the picture was blindsided because I used to see only from my perspective. A mentor helps you to see a three-dimensional picture of your performance. He has an overview. He can see your weaknesses better than you yourself. So he could have guided me. Okay, Prabhat, you can make timetable like this. See, you're not so punctual. See, you're distracted. In my mind, I was perfect. So that mentorship role, mentorship plays that important role of keeping you in the track. It's like a horse running in a race and there are two barricades on the side. People think that barricades are very irrelevant, but no, they are the most important part. For a horse not getting out of the race track, that two barricades plays the most important role. because that's what keeps you in the race.
Great. So, Prabhat, you have interacted with our team, right? You have understand our mentorship program here at Civils Daily. Do you think, like, what is your perception of it? Do you think having an individual mentor with yourself throughout this journey, guiding you through each step, whatever test you give, giving an analysis of those tests, do you think this is beneficial? This idea is beneficial?
Definitely. This is a very good idea, in fact. And I was lucky to, as I said, I was lucky to have mentors like you without any, getting into coaching. I still remember 2019 prelims in which I cleared the prelims for the first time. And I called you up 15 to 20 days ago, I still remember. And you told me the three rounds to how to take prelims test paper, because I was not scoring good anyway in the mocks back then. And I was very scared. I think so you will be the right person to tell everyone that how to take the three rounds of prelim test papers. Not now, even in this process. So I followed that. I gave the same mantra to 2-3 of my friends. And it worked out good for everyone. You're all four of us cleared with that. So this last moment tips from the people who are experienced and who have faced. Similar thing happened with me in the interview when I think Civils Daily, it was my first interview. Civils Daily when I gave my first interview. After that, the feedback from you, Anuj, continuously for that, how to go about the interview. Because you knew me personally and a mentor knows a student personally. A mentor is not just a professional person, right? It's not a teacher you go to and tell him, sir, I cannot write this answer, please guide me. A mentor will tell you particularly how you are equipped to write this answer, yes, knowing your pros and cons. So our personal guidance with a touch will help you get your scores, your marks, your direction. I think so.
So just when you came, a few students posted a question, sir, like in initial phase of preparation, like what kind of mistakes one should avoid? Okay, you, because it took you a lot of time, so you know the pitfalls that the students fall in the initial phase of preparation. Okay, so can you give a shed some light on what kind of pitfalls do you think you fell in or you have seen other people falling in, will which led to the failure in this examination?
There are three major things I would like to tell. See, everyone knows the every source is open in the market right now. Okay, what books to refer. But I'll tell you three things I personally feel is what every aspirant who comes into service preparation should do. First is keep your sources very limited. This mistake I've done. Okay. So, I used to, for geography, after completing NCRT, I went for Majid Hussain in the first 2 years without not being an optional student to get into more depth. So, I could neither revise before my prelims Majid Hussain, neither I could revise NCRT. I had confidence, oh, I know geography good, I've read well. But then this was fake, this was pseudo-knowledge because there was no revision, no recall. And UPSC will get into the intricacies of concepts even in prelims, even in the main. So, first thing is you have to keep your sources limited. That is the first thing I would like to tell you everyone. That don't go about reading everything, just read minimum thing, maximum text. Second is, do not follow any topper or any senior blindly. The common mistake which I did was I came, I saw, okay, this topper, and I started following them and their schedule and the way they read, their sources they read. My first mistake was I followed the guidance of Shah Faisal sir. He was a topper of UPSC, and yeah, I forgot to realize that he was an AIIMS topper and he was reading throughout his life. He was an academician throughout his life. So his aptitude and his attitude towards studying was very different because he could study for 10 to 12 hours, 14 hours in a single course text. And I could not do that. So whatever goals I made would definitely fail, right? Because his goals were different, my goals were different, my aptitudes were different. So choose your mentor or choose your guiding like thoroughly, very delicately. Match your aptitude to people who are from your background. For example, in 2019, I got to see a blog of Vaishali Singh. She's she was 8th or 9th ranked 2018 law graduate. So this helped me because she was a law graduate. Her temperament and her knowledge base was similar to mine. And her answer writing was similar to mine. I saw her model answers paper because she was from a law background. And I could relate how she explained in the video that, okay, since I'm a law graduate, so I have a habit to write long answers. So my problem was to concise them. So these things I could relate. So don't follow any topper or any blog from any civil service aspirant to a person who has cleared it blindly. Have a talk with your mentor. He will analyze your personality. Then he can tell you the best people who belong to your personality criteria. And then you can follow those toppers and their suggestions. And then you can make a timetable. And third thing, which based on first two, which is very important, is self-realization. Of your own caliber and your potential. If you over calculate your personality and you think, okay, I can do more, and in actual you cannot. So again, your goals and your targets will be missed. This will be again frustrating for you. And if you under-realize your potentials, again, then your goals and target will be missed. So these three things are very essential, I think so. When you start preparation, you need to know your potential. For knowing your potential, there are good amount of mock tests. Now, back then, we did not have so many mock tests and personality assessment tests. Then again comes the role of mentor. For example, for me, it was Oja sir who guided me in the initial years that this is your potential and you can go this far. So I think so. A mentor will again play a good role in the third point, self-realization. He can tell you your nooks and counts. You can have a good test. There are many personality tests can be.
So Prabhat, just when you gave an example of Shah Faisal sir, there's a perception among students that it's only the good students, academically good students who are toppers, who qualify this examination. Like many times students fear getting to this field because they know it's the toppers only that they qualify. Like, but we being in this field, we know that, right? Toppers, academically brilliant, brilliance doesn't matter, success in UPSC, right? So what's your take on that?
I am a strong believer of this point that it is not just meant for brilliant or good academic students since starting. I totally oppose this idea, and I wanted to desperately prove this, that even without good coaching classes from big banners, and not being from any very good engineering college or from a medical background or from quota or some place is needed to get into civil services. Had this been true, so every IIT or IIM person would have been into civil services, right? And secondly, this was also a motivating factor for me because I was a very average student, okay? But I was always confident, okay? Because I used to meet people who have cleared exams, and when I used to talk to them, when you interact with toppers, this is one thing which will help you to analyze yourself as well. When I used to speak to them, I used to realize, okay, see, I'm not very far from them in terms of intellectual level or in way of dealing with issues, I think so. Only the issue is I'm not able to crack this exam. So this exam is just a door which you need to open to get into the other room where there are civil servants and here we are aspirants. If you have the right key, then you can definitely get in. And to get that key, UPSC has never said that you have to be an IIT and or AIIMS passer. So sometimes you overthink and you miss that key. Maybe you have 10 keys in your hand and you just don't try because there are so many keys, I'm not going to try. You just have to try and try and try. Maybe it can be the first key that you get in, or it can be the 10th. But eventually, if your desire to get in is there, I think so, it will overcome people who come from different fields because unlike us, who have nothing to lose because we already are bankrupt in terms of academics or anything, you have already nothing, right? But people who come from IITs or IIMs, or they have too much on stake to lose, because if they give 7 or 8 years or 4 or 5 years dedicated to civil services, then they are left nowhere, right? But we have nothing to lose. So there should be also motivating factor that we have nothing to lose. But if we get inside that room once, there's a lot to gain. So I think so. This myth has to come over by a student by himself or herself, that it is not meant for only good aspirants or people who can sit initially in the 12-14 hours. Sitting is very essential, but okay, you can develop that gradually. It doesn't matter.
So Prabhat, let's get into the practicality of examination. Okay. So first question here, I'll ask that is, What changes in your preparation did you make in 2017-18, right? That ultimately led to the success in 2019 examination and state services also. There must be some radical changes that you made, like you understood that previous things were not working. I know personal and professionally you were not doing very good at that time, right? So what changes or radical changes that you made that finally worked for you?
Ajay, the first thing which I made was I cancelled all the other plans, because which you had also mentioned, and I realized when I started preparing, I always was worried about plan B initially. There has to be plan B, no issue. But that is when you give your 100% and you don't achieve anything, then you can think, okay, I should have a backup. Initially, I used to always keep working on some of the other thing apart from my civil services. So that kept me very distracted. Okay. So in 2017 attempts, when I did not clear again, and my margin of error was every time very minuscule. It was in 2016, I missed by 2 marks. In 2017, I missed again by 2.5 marks. And both these times, I marked 2 answers in my OMR wrong. I filled wrong circles in my examination, both these papers. So my so it clearly showed that lack of concentration in the paper. Again, then it showed a lack of consistency and a little bit of anxiety in the examination hall. Okay, how, these all were the result of lack of clear-headed mind. So in 2018, my first thing which I did was I cleared my head that I won't do nothing else. I did not think of any other job. I thought everything is lost. I just need to clear UKC or any state TCS for a backup right now, for my job right now. So this is the first thing. I dedicatedly gave 1 year of preparation. I took drop in 2018. I started with the syllabus. I took the first word of the syllabus until the last word of the syllabus. And I did not go for 100% preparation, I tell you clearly. I was smart enough to identify that you need to get only 60% in mains. So I chose those subjects in which I was good enough. So I made them my strong area. So for example, for geography for me was good. Paper 2 was good. Paper 3 was good. I'm very bad at philosophy and a little ethical part. So I said I can work upon them, but to make sure that I do not fall in those pitfalls, but I made my stronger area more stronger. I made them my weapon. So this was the second change which I brought in my preparation. Earlier, I used to run about my weaknesses. For example, I was very bad at economy earlier. So I used to keep reading economy, but again, it was of no help. And I used to miss history and polity, which was my strong point. But in this attempt, what I did, I read history more, I read polity more, so that I make no mistakes there. And in my weaknesses, out of 10, I tried, okay, I can get at least 5 right. So I'll make that my not so weak part. Weak part can be made, not so weak part or an average part. But I made my good part a stronger part. This was the second change I made. And the third change I made was I changed my study orientation from PE oriented to mains oriented. This is a common mistake which I think so most of the students make in the preparation. From day one, they are worried about prelims. I know prelims is the most important part. But again, for the first time in these many years, I started preparing thoroughly only for mains. And this is when I was prepared. I started preparing for mains in August 2018. I still remember. And my first phase finished on 6th November 2018. So that is when I took the first break. And then again, I started revising the entire syllabus for my Gujarat mains, which was supposed to be in February 2019. And it took me 3 months to revise. November, December, and 26th January 2019, I took my second break. And in 3 months, I had revised the entire syllabus twice. So on 26 January 2019, I made a call to Urja sir. I still remember I called him and I said, sir, I'm ready. I think so, even any paper, I can solve it right now. So when you see previous year question in papers after this preparation and your any mock test series papers of GS mains, it gives you a sense of confidence. So I was confident about mains. Now the only thing was left for me was prelims. So then, after giving my Gujarat mains, I came and I started taking mock tests for prelims as well. And this time in prelims, I made some changes. This we'll discuss when we come to the prelims question. But again, the third thing which needs to be done is you need to start preparing mains oriented initially. You need to cover subject holistically. Prelims is factual, so you can definitely cover this prelims portion given the time 4 months before the examination. And meanwhile, I used to keep solving 20-30 questions on the phone application. You have these benefit VRAs. So I used to solve every day 30-40 questions on the phone, walking here and there. So on an average, you solve 30-40 questions in a day. So your guessing also keeps improving in these 4-5 months. So these three major changes I made in my approach. In note making and all that, we'll discuss in the next question.
So first of all, let's talk about the first stage of preparation. Like, when did you start preparing for prelims focused preparation? Okay, how much time did you dedicate and how many mocks did you attempt for preliminary examination?
See, prelim was a weak point for me because I could not clear prelims 4 times and it was my 5th attempt. And this was very crucial for me because in my mind, that was the last. Because after that, I could not afford to keep into only civil, but I had also cleared my state exams and I had to join my state services in a couple of months. So before prelims, I think so, I exactly dedicated around 110 days for prelim preparation, in which initially 15-20 days was a transition phase. Because what happens when you start, when you keep reading only for mains, so you cannot directly switch your mind in a day, okay, I need to study for prelims. Because your mind will resist, because in studying for mains is very holistic, right? You see subjects in a broader way, you don't get into minute details, and that is totally opposite to the preparation for prelims. So I was very much aware that this will happen with me mentally. So I gave 110 days, initial 10-15 days I gave for this particular transition only, in which my mind rebelled at times, okay, I don't want to study for prelims, this is exhausting, mains was easy. The study for prelims is boring. These kind of ideas will ridicule your mind. But then you need to understand that you need to get in that particular shoe of getting into prelims. So 90 days, before 90 days, I was actually in the shoes to study only for prelims. I used to give, I divided my day into 2 parts. One was paper solution and one was preparation and revision. So the first thing in paper solution I did was I used to revise my current affairs in the morning, in the first phase. I used to reach library by 7:38 and I used to revise my current affairs in the first phase of the morning. By 11:30 I was good. Then I used to take one mock test for 2 hours. Then take lunch break. After that I used to solve that, make that entire solution. And at the evening, 6 or 6:30, doing the solution, I used to go for revision of any particular subject which I need to read. For example, geography, history, whatever you plan. But one thing I made a change in solving papers in 2019 was, this is not good for everyone. They can divide their own strategies. I'll just tell you mine. I never solved the paper for which I was reading. For example, when I started, so I started for geography. For example, I was taking geography mock test. So in the evening time, I used to read polity. And when I read polity, I made at least after 15 days I took polity mock test so that I could see how much I could retain and how much, you know, I could perform even after 10 to 15 days. So this was my particular strategy, and this also helped me in 2 ways, because while solving a test paper you read and revise, right? And after 15 days when I read that particular subject, it gave me a second revision of my test paper as well. So when I went to polity after 15 days, I quickly picked up the papers which I solved for polity. I saw the short notes of the test papers which I read wrong. I revised them. I used to revise them initially in 2-3 hours. Then I used to get into my polity, test book. So this was a change, second change. So 90, 110 days, 15-20 days to shift. Divide your day into 2 parts. One is for reading current affairs and subject, 2 to 4 hours, 6 hours. And 6 hours of this paper. And I used to give 4 or 5 tests a week, 4 to 5 tests in a week. And I made sure I gave only one test series completely from 1 to 40 full tests. I mean, from you can take any test series, I think so. But you need to make sure that you solve the first paper to the last paper, because they have a plan to cover in the test series. And I made sure that this time, which was the biggest mistake which I did in all the 4 attempts, I never revised the mock test paper which I gave. I used to keep giving tests. I used to keep doing this. I used to make 60. Earlier, I used to give 90 mock tests, 80 to 90 mock tests, and you get score good, right? Never used to revise them. This year, I gave 45 tests, 19. I revised all the 45 tests. Once all these were over, so I went for full mock land test in centers. In 2019, there were mock tests held by Vision, Drishti at schools and different centers. So that I gave to rectify my mistake of OMR filling. I told you I have filled two wrong circles in two attempts.
Yes.
So these mock tests I went to give into different centers to see that I don't fill any wrong circles. And to my surprise, even till the last mock test, I have filled wrong circles in every of the mock tests in the centers. But I made this thing sure that in examination in 2019, I did not do that. And I did not do in 2019 any wrong circles. So this also helped. So giving mock tests in different centers and going offline centers, or this also helps you a lot. So I would suggest that students can take around 110 days before minimum before prelims if you are confident with your preparation of mains. And then divide your day into part two. Take one mock test of any test series at least, full, do it completely, revise them once at least before, say 20-25 days before your prelims. Once all of this, then you can go for full length test of any testable. Then it is, you're already prepared for a match, and then you can just use it to go on the pitch and take some mock tests.
Yeah.
So I was so confident, and was my exam was on 2nd June. I made my second exam on 15th May. So mentally, I was prepared on 15th May. So preponing your target is also a very motivating thing, because on 15th May, I was ready for prelims. So because it had happened to me a couple of years before that, before my examination, something used to happen. I used to get sick or someone in the family. So I made that contingency plan in my prelims this time. Even if anything happens, I have 15 days extra in my hand. So that's it.
So to summarize, I believe two, three things that worked for you. First of all, you analyzed your performance. You analyzed your weaknesses. What were the pitfalls you were falling in, right? Everybody should do that, right? At least know your strength and weaknesses before going into the examination hall. Secondly, your revision strategy was very proper, right? You had a proper plan for a strategy for revision. And last, you dedicated a specific time for pre and mains, understanding the importance of each. In my opinion, still this year, UPSC has postponed the examination. We have 4 months for prelims. So right now, any person who starts right now for this year, this is also good, sufficient time, provided you have read the basic of UPSC, right? Main syllabuses are complete. So prelims ke liye sufficient time hai abhi. The only idea is one should have a clear strategy how to proceed, right? Without clear strategy, nahi hoga.
Okay. Not a whole
area. Good. So now the next question, you have already answered it. When and how did you start your preparing for mains? You told that you gave 1 year entire for mains, right? Where you gave you did your notes making and everything, right? Another question just before comes, like two questions. First of all, when did you start practicing your answer writing, from the day one or when? And second, that is a daily answer writing necessary?
So I'll answer your first question, that when did I started writing my answer? As I mentioned, in 2017, I could not clear the prelims. So the result was out by August, September. So in 18, I did not take the prelims and I was not well and something. So August 18, 8th August 2018, I started my mains preparation. So in which I started with the basic books again. And this time I limited my resources. I'll read only NCERTs for geography. For history, I'll revise only my notes. So I made a list of those notes. It probably ended for 18 books for me. 18 books and registers for me. I'll tell my personal thing. On 8th of August, I read each and everything from first page to last page. And this took me till 6th November. So once or twice when I've gone through entire my syllabus, I've known every word written on the syllabus of UPSC. This I did in the first phase. All right. On 6th November, it was Diwali, so I finished my first round. Once I've read it all, then after taking my, when I started my second round, I did not go for mock tests. first what I did is I took previous year question unsolved and I started with two answers per day. I had a friend, her name is Garima. So we were in the same library. So we started writing two answers per day and we would check each other's answers and enhance, right? So initially two answers gave me good boost. That, okay, two answers were good enough. And I would not start with those questions which I never knew. Okay, these students all often, you know, you start writing direct answers from the friend website. I'll tell you a common mistake. A friend of mine, he started with us. He started writing for answers from Insights website. It's a good website. They give 5 to 6 questions. He said, I will write from that. I'll write 2 questions. What happened? Eventually, in 1 or 2 weeks, he stopped writing answers at all. So the reason he told us ki yaar usne aise question poochne kabhi padha hi nahi. So what happens when you have not read anything and you start writing about it? So what will happen? It might benefit you, but again there are chances that in the initial stage you might take a step back and you stop answer writing at all in totality. So for example, that mistake I did not do. I said I was well aware of my capability. So I started writing answers for history, geography, for which I had basic ideas. Ki haan, history mein ye hua, geography mein ye hua, polity mein ye hua. Then when I had a good grip of answer writing and it became a habit for me that I have to write 2 answers every day, then we went on to different current affairs questions. And by November end, December end, I started taking mock tests. So I would say that the second question now, which is very important, which you said, do you need to write daily answers? I think so. There's no one strategy. I think so. You have to blend to both of these. Initially, you have to start with 1 or 2 answers daily. So initially, when you start, you have to write 1 or 2 answers daily because it will help you to come out of your comfortable zone, right? It will make you a little uncomfortable and then you will be ready for the adversities. But once you are out of this 1 or 2 answers a day, and you get the a hand on writing answers, then you can go for weekly 1 mock test, or you can go for 10 answers in every 3 days to 5 days, which I did particularly. I used to take 10 questions every 3 days. So by this, I solved my mock test. By February end, I had finished almost around 400 answers in different subjects. So I made sure that I write at least 100 answers for GS1. For GS2 and GS3, I wrote 150 answers. For ethics, I wrote only 50 answers. So this is how I did. So initially, I started with 1 answer a day. And later on, it was 3 days, after 3 days, 1 test.
So for all the help of all the students, I'll be sending some samples of the notes making that Prabhat has done. Okay, it will give you an idea how to consolidate your notes and see, I believe this worked for Prabhat, right? That having a consolidated notes on each topic, right? For example, cyclones, you should have a single page dedicated to cyclones where all the dimensions, why, how they are created, why there are more cyclones in Bay of Bengal, things like that. Right, Prabhat?
Yes, definitely.
So this
helps you during main preparation because
it helps you revise and consolidate whatever you have read. Right, because you keep on reading from multiple sources, from standard books, NCERTs, newspaper, everything is coming. So I think Prabhat also had his, and we also did that. You should have 4 registers for paper 1, paper 2, paper 3, paper 4, and divide them into sections. And whatever you are reading, whatever you think, data, facts, points which are important, you should keep noting down in those 4 registers. So at the end of 1 year, you will have those four registers, which you can easily revise, prepare and consolidate for the main exam. Right, Prabhat? That's all for notes making?
Yes, yes.
2 paper for UPSC are most scoring, I believe. The ethics and essay. Right? So how did you go about these 2 papers?
As I said, mentioned, I'm not good with much philosophy and all. So I had to work on this to create a service because optional and all are okay. But in GS, essay and ethics plays the most important. These 2 subjects will decide your rank, right? Other subjects may get you inside the civil services, but these 2 subjects will decide your services and rank. For essay and ethics, the preparation can go mostly hand in hand. As you have mentioned earlier, I remember you were talking about examples. So those same examples come in handy for SAP. So what I did was, a friend of mine, she told me that what you can do is for attitude. For example, there is attitude. So she told me to write three examples for attitude. One example on your basis, how I can make an example on attitude. One example of attitude which you have seen eyes of a second person. And third, one example of attitude picked up from the newspaper. So for ethics, what I did, I took every topic for emotional intelligence. Then I wrote three examples, individual example, third person example, and society example. So three examples, these I took. Then if I find a relevant quote or a slope from Indian mythology, I had written them together in that particular topic. So this is how I could value add in my ethics paper. Because I was not very good with philosophy, right? So if you're not good in philosophy, so you cannot master philosophy in 1 year. So what I did, I added value to my answers through examples and quotations. Relevant, not irrelevant. Please make it a point, because one irrelevant example in a quotation will strike you off out of the question. So you need to be very careful that only relevant things are mentioned. And secondly, for ethics and essay, I read Yojana and Kurukshetra both thoroughly. Because Yojana, this was very helpful. Yojana and Kurukshetra, we often, I think so, maximum players, everyone will tell you that they are relevant. I don't think so, because they are very relevant for your essay and ethics paper. Because people only read Yojana and Kurukshetra from the perspective of GS3, but I would tell them that no, when you write, for example, an answer on agriculture scenario in India, farm sector, right? So for GS3, you'll write bullet points, you'll write the facts, and it is over. But for essay, you have to write that particular thing in 50 words in a very well-crafted manner that it appeals the person who is reading it in a very simple language. And who better can do that than Yojana and Kurukshetra? Because these magazines are very simple written, very simple English. I have never found a situation in which I had to Google a word from Yojana or Kurukshetra. I don't think this ever happened. It is very simple English. The entire flow of the answer is there. There is an introduction, there is a body, there is a conclusion, there is a way forward. And apart from just writing the factual thing, they make the factual, technical subject into humanitarian approach. For example, if they discuss Jam Trinity, so they won't just discuss the technical points. They will tell the societal impacts in a very comprehensive language. Because in essay, you need to write subjectively. You cannot write bullet points. So I read Yojana and Kurukshetra for my ethics and essay. And value addition in particular topics. This is how I did it.
Great. So valuable insights there. The last stage of this examination is your personality test, right? And as we discussed, it's going to be conducted within a couple of months. So how does one go about the personality test? How important is to fill your DAF and how to curate it? And what all did you prepare for your personality test?
Okay. For personality test, I'll address the question in two parts. First part will be my DAF and what are the things you need to consider. So in DAF, you need to see there are two options. Either you go with a mentor or either a coaching class who give you guidance and all, right? And how to go about the task. Or secondly, if you're confident about yourself, for in case this was my case, I filled my task knowing myself that, okay, even if I ask question on any of these sections, I would be comfortable enough to answer. So first, making while writing task, you need to be sure that whatever you're writing, you know about it. Okay, don't bluff and just don't make your DAF voluminous. It needs to be lean and precise. Students, if asked achievement, they start writing achievement. I have seen a DAF with 10 achievements. Okay, and when the particular student was asked questions about the achievement, we could not, very well justify them. So no one doubts that you have not achieved it particularly. But what they are concerned is if you have achieved that, so you need to be well aware of it, right? You cannot say that I have achieved it and I have forgotten it. So mention only those things which you are good and comfortable with even today. If you have if you were a badminton champion in school, but you cannot, you are not at all in touch with badminton anymore, or you have no relevance of sportsman spirit in your current personality or life right now, then avoid mentioning that badminton achievement in your tabs, I would suggest. Because either you will only read about badminton, the court dimension, and they might ask a totally different question of current affairs of badminton, which you are totally unaware of. Okay, so while filling that, you need to be well aware about all those questions which you can answer right now and which you are comfortable with. Do not bluff in your DAF. Just be very lean and very precise in your DAF. Even if you don't have much thing to write in your DAF, trust me, those students have also scored 206. The person I know, a friend of mine, he has scored 206 in an interview. He did not have a hobby. He did not have an interest section. Because he could not afford an interest. Because he said, I was working throughout my life and I was from a good economical background. So they asked me, you do not have an interest, and I simply said that I could not afford an interest because I was working right after my 12th. So I was working and I was studying. So you need to not make bluff, or you do not need to bluff in the interview and all DAF. So in DAF also, you need to be very clear-headed. Okay. Secondly, preparation of your interview. It starts with your DAF again. The first word in your DAF, you need to analyze it from all the angles till the last word. I remember coming to you and Sivas really, and you people have helped me by making precise questions on the DAF-oriented. DAF-oriented questions were given to me, in which the questions were like, what is the meaning of a name, meaning of a name in one single line, then about my hobbies. So these questions, which you cannot analyze personally, a third person helps you analyze. So the more question you stick with your DAF, will make you confident. Because see, no one knows what will be asked in the interview, okay? Mm-hmm. It's open-ended. You cannot think and go that, okay, I'll be asked only about these things. But what is expected, that whatever you have written in the DAF, that you are aware about. For example, if they ask me out of the box that what is happening in Chile or Peru, I can tell them, sorry sir, I'm not aware. Then you are excused. But if they ask you, Prabhat, can you tell us something about Delhi? Since you have stayed here 8 years, I cannot tell them, no, I am not aware of it. Because it is written in your DAF, that word is in your DAF. So, the confidence which you will get while getting into the interview hall will come from preparation of your detailed application form. The day you have covered your DAF holistically from first word to last word, I think so you will be confident enough to get into it.
So, in the meanwhile, for all the students, I am posting the link for our scholarship program. Right now, we are providing 15% scholarship for all the students who enroll within 48 hours for all our mentorship program. So you can connect with our mentors and they will give you a guidance and how to prepare. Okay. How did you manage current affairs, which like it's overwhelming right now, right? So many sources of current affairs, so many videos, so many materials. It's overwhelming. How did you manage your current affairs?
Ajay, for me, current affairs, it happened to come out a blessing in disguise because I don't have too many devices with me. So I was not too much into YouTube and all, but any digital source that year. But I restricted myself to two things. One was the current newspaper. I have read Hindu religiously, and I read Indian Express explained section religiously. Explained helps you get you direct answers. They are direct answers for your UPSC. For a particular topic, if you can identify that it is relatable, it's a direct answer, the explained section. And the third thing is, I used to follow Vision Current Affairs monthly. And apart from this, I never read anything. And that's what my GS paper 3, which was very difficult in our attempt. The highest score was 102 and I scored around 99 marks based on these notes only. The best thing was when I used to read Vision, I used to immediately send you a note of cyclone and one particular topic, recommendations of GMR. So these are notes from Vision only. So what I used to do is, I would take a printout like this of Vision and right behind the page, I would make a note like this.
Yes.
So what would happen when I would revise? So I would not revise the entire vision page. I would just revise my particular note. And if anything extra has to be written, I'll refer to the notes which I have already marked. So for this helped me save my time, revise my monthly current page. So I at the end, in one day, I could revise 4 or 5 months. This is to happen. In 10 to 12 hours, I could revise 5 to 6 months of current affairs very quickly and very fast. Because I would make a note right behind the page, mains and pre. So for mains, if I had to read for mains, I would read the left side. And for pre, I used to read the right side. So I did not have to get into too much of the note making. So there is already too much material. So you do not have to go about this. And apart from that, Dhuri Shetty sir once have mentioned the blogs of Civil Daily in which you have good editorial discussion. So I used to bookmark them and take a printout of it every month. So I have it in my other site. So the blog description of Civil Daily, you have some important article, just write it down in Evernote or copy paste it and take a printout of that particular blog. So I did not go for many current affairs. I used to revise them. Hindi newspaper itself, I used to make notes, and this machine.
So, in my opinion, and I believe you will also agree, that any source of current affairs, any one source of current affairs would do, but you have to prepare it thoroughly, revise it, and make notes. Right? It doesn't matter if you are referring to Vision, Vajiram, or any other book. One source and revise it.
Because every coaching will try to make the best note. No one wants that their student will stay, right? So they'll give you the best. It depends totally on you how you prepare that material thoroughly.
Okay, so two questions more. The last two questions. First, about your law optional. It's too wide, too big, too bulky. How did you go about it?
For law, I'll tell you clearly, I had a guidance from Nirvana Lawyers, Karandeep sir, and he was very supportive throughout the preparation. Right from the day of prelims, when I cleared, I sent him my score. He has a thing that the day of prelims, you need to calculate and tell him that, sir, this is my score. And he would make a dedicated batch for people who are writing. So in that, what he tells everyone is to, initially we prepare 50% of the law syllabus before prelims. So this I was sure that we do at least the 50% of syllabus before prelims, because in law you have constitution which is very bulky. You cannot expect to revise constitution and administrative law right after the prelim along with the other subjects. So this we made sure that we studied constitution and administration law paper 1 before the prelims only. And some of it is relevant in the prelims as well, the constitution, the quality part. Right after the prelims, without wasting time, in law optional, you have to start revising in the days between your prelims and the result of your prelims. So, during the prelims and mains, I did, since I was already confident with my GS preparation, as I had mentioned, I have already revised the syllabus twice. So, this gave me an edge in my optional. So, it does not matter that if you do not give law optional your optional too much time in the before. If you give that dedicated time to GS, this will all give you an added advantage during the prelims and mains. Because unlike other people, I do not have to read current affairs. I have seen many people joining coaching after the prelims for current affairs. But I was very sure about it. So what I did, I gave that time to. So I used to study 8 hours for optional and 4 hours for GS during my prelims and mains. So this helped me a lot, and this helped me cover the law syllabus. And I had made short notes of law. I don't have it right now. I'll share it with you. I had made the entire short notes of every topic of law in probably 100 or 150 words of every topic, which has to be done because in law there's too much material, too much. So you need to make concise 150 word answers for that. So I made short notes for that and a revision of the same notes again and again. You know, that helps you keep good confidence in law.
The same strategy that you adopted for GS means preparing concise notes and revising, that worked for your optional also,
right.
So the last question for today is, see, you qualified GPSC, right? But you didn't join, right? Or did you join?
I joined it, but after that I have an interview, so I resigned in
So is it possible to prepare along with a job? Like most of the students ask this question, that is it able, like they are able to dedicate 4 hours or 5 hours every day for UPSC studies. Is it possible to qualify this exam along with a job?
I would be very much positive for this answer. I think so. It's very much possible to clear this exam with a job. And I have seen many different examples. Because when you start working, your concentration level and your time constraint works as a motivating factor to finish off the syllabus and to do timely work. All right. And when you're studying entire day and you're nothing else to do, you can procrastinate your goals, right? But in with job, you are very your schedule is very tight. Your goals have to be finished in a limited amount of time. So this also helped me. Yes, initially you will have some setbacks. For my interview preparation, I had my setbacks. But then I had the support of the seniors and I got my lead, but not everyone is so lucky, right? So, but again, I've seen people who have just taken 10 days, 15 days leave before the interview and they've scored good 180, 190, 200 marks in the interview as well. So I don't think so. Job is any more a burden. But yes, if you can, if you have the willpower and the strategy, right? For people who are into job, I think so. Strategy and mentorship is very, 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 very important. Because you cannot just run like people who are giving 24 hours only for profession. Because they have a edge of time management. People who are sitting at home. But if you're working, you need to have a meticulous plan of every day and every week. For that, I think so, a mentor or a good guide or a strategy is very much necessary.
So you should have a guidance or at least connect with people who are in the process, right? Be it your friends, be it your seniors, right, or any kind of guidance that would do, right? Great.
Right.
So that finishes the questions from my side.
So Prabhat, your story has been an inspiration for a lot of us. A lot of students and for me personally, right? And definitely it shows that like adversity, coming over adversities, and you can achieve success in this examination. I know you are still preparing and we all wish that you will get that worthy ki naukri, the IPS this time. Okay? Thank you for your time. Okay? See you soon.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Prabhat.
Thank you.
Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon on the YouTube app and never miss another update from Civils Daily.